Good morning, church family, and happy Sabbath to you and your loved ones. We're so glad to be in the house of the Lord together. I hope that you have enjoyed our Sabbath school time. I enjoyed being in the side room here, having a stimulating discussion on the book of Jonah, who even at the end of the book was not at rest in his position with God. But we are so thankful to all the different teachers of the Sabbath schools. It's lovely hearing the music and the joyful sounds coming as they are learning and growing in the knowledge of our benevolent Lord. Hope that you are blessed today. I am reminded that we tend to do announcements at the end of church service here, and so we're going to go right into our opening hymn, which is Oh How I Love Jesus. And there's a kid's version of this song that might be pretty well known, but did you know it's actually a hymn in our hymnal as well? We're going to sing the grown-up version today. It is a beautiful one. Let's stand and sing together. There is a name I love to hear. Your children, dear Heavenly Father, we love living in the grace of your benevolence day in and day out, and we pray that this service is pleasing in your sight. Please send your Holy Spirit to bless us and guide us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I have to tell you, you may be seated. I have to tell you, every time I come to the Orange SDA Church, I am pleasantly surprised by the high percentage of little boys and girls and big boys and girls who are here at church to worship the Lord. We always give a priority time to our kids, and so we're going to ask who we fondly call Aunt Linda to come forward and tell us a story just for the younger boys and girls, and for those of us who are grown-ups too, we probably have a place in our heart where a young child resides, and so let's access that part of our mind today too. You can take it off the stand.
Does Pastor Tatum have a kid's slide, do you think? I think he does. I'd like you to hold that picture just for now. That reminds me of 20-some years ago. I was on the phone with a good girlfriend of mine who lived in Michigan. I've hit a certain number of years in my life, And I thought, I need some exercise. And we were talking about a gym or something, and she said to me, Linda, just get on a pair of walking shoes and go outside and walk. And I thought, well, that's awfully straightforward. And so I did. And it turned out I needed better shoes. And then I needed better clothes. And then I needed something on my head to keep the sun out. But over time, it was absolutely right. Didn't cost a dime. I calculated over the last 24 years, I walk 4 miles a week, 4 times a week, that's 16 miles a week. In a month, that was 64 miles. In a year, that was 768 miles. And if I had religiously done that, which I haven't, because of course there are days you don't walk and trips you take, I could have theoretically walked 19,200 miles. My husband tells me that's 2/3 of around the globe. So I could have done a lot of walking. You know, I observed a lot. And I felt it was important to enjoy that walk. I want to ask you all a question. Kids, here's a question. Like the next slide, please. What is the first job that you heard of in the Bible? Who were the first people? Adam and Eve, right. Did they just sit around doing nothing? What was their job? Anybody? What? Well, yeah, in the Garden of Eden where they lived. Was it just the animals? No. It was all kinds of wonderful things, growing things. They cared for the earth, didn't they? Could you go back one for me? Thank you. Yes, they cared for the earth. They were the first people in the world, and their primary job was to take care of the earth. Is that our job today? Is that our job today, care for the earth? Oh, I don't think so. Somebody else can do that, right? No. We all need to be aware of the earth, don't we? You can see that God created the earth for us to protect. Now, did Adam and Eve have to protect anything in the Garden of Eden, really? Was there a danger there? There was one thing they couldn't do, wasn't there? But other than that, they pretty much had a pretty nice life. And they needed to improve. They needed to work and grow things to eat. And of course, they had children. And they also enjoyed it. And those are the exact same things we need to be doing right now. And you might say, well, you know, there's not really much I can do to protect the earth. Well, you protect yourself, you protect your family, you protect your house, you protect your church, you protect your heart, your body. Of course, there are a lot of things that we need to protect now. And we need to improve them, don't we? If we can, if we must, if we work at it. And of course, the big thing is enjoying it, isn't it? I'm going to take you now, if you'll do the next picture, I'm going to take you for a walk in our neighborhood. We live in West. It's everywhere for us to take care of and enjoy. And I hope that you will open your eyes to the nature and the beauty of our world and commit today in your heart to be like Adam and Eve, doing what you can to take care of it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We tend to kind of whoosh by our neighborhoods as we go in the car, but you notice a lot more when you take it at a walking speed, don't you? Maybe this afternoon, if you have a little time, take a walk in your neighborhood and see the beauty that God has given for us. Amen? We're going to continue our singing time with a few more songs. I'm going to grab my guitar and my lovely wife sing in harmony. Thank you. You may know that the big part of our Bible, the bigger half, is the Old Testament, and it is written in the language of Hebrew. And the way that you see praise the Lord in Hebrew, in fact, anytime in your Bible, if you're reading the book of Psalms or whatever, and you see it say praise the Lord, the way that they would say that in the language of Hebrew was hallelujah. Probably a lot of us come to church and sing hallelujah, and we don't even really know what it means, but that's how we praise God in the original language. I was trying to remember if I have sung this song here at Orange with you before, but whether we have or haven't, it's not a terribly difficult song. The chorus talks about how recognizing God's love gives us so many reasons to sing. So maybe learn it through the first chorus, and then you can sing moving forward from there. It goes like this. Hallelujah. But he promises David blessings and peace and success, and that his children will reign on the throne. And David is so overwhelmed with gratitude, he says, "Who am I that such a wonderful and great God would consider me?" And this same idea comes to us, that God would consider us, that God would love us, that God would save us. Who am I? Is it profoundly because of who we are, or because of God's wonderful characteristics of who he is? What would you say, friends? It's because of God, amen? But this song captures that sentiment. Let's sing that song together. probably pretty well known. Who am I? Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my worth? Who am I that the bright morning star would choose to light the way for my ever-wandering heart? Not because of who I am, because of his goodness, has looked upon us. He has also saved us with the sacrifice of his dearly beloved Son, dear Lord Jesus, which is still efficacious to our benefit. Amen? We can plead the blood of Jesus over all of our sins. We can give all our anxieties to him, and it is because it never ceases to have power. Our third song this morning, well-known hymn, Power in the Blood. Let's sing it joyfully.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? This power.
In the precious blood of the Lamb.
We're going to continue on with prayer time and scripture time from another room.
Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, such a beautiful day, such beauty in this earth still. And yet, Lord, we have so much trouble even keeping the world healthy and happy and clean, as it was mentioned. And Lord, we ask that the presence of the Holy Spirit will be with us today. We ask, Lord, that you will guide us every day, Lord, into a better and stronger relationship with you. And as we come to understand that love that you have for us, Lord, that we will not keep it to ourselves, but that we will share that love with someone, whoever it may be that we come in contact with. Let us never be ashamed to tell others about this great gift of Jesus Christ. Blessed be your name, Lord, and guide us through the rest of this Sabbath school and sermon. And at that, we ask a very special prayer, Pastor Tatum, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will anoint his lips with the blessings that you have asked him to tell the church today. And may the rest of us, Lord, be receptive to the word. For we ask these things in your blessed and holy name. Amen. Let me ask you a question. Are you happy? Let me ask you a question again. Are you happy?
Yes.
Amen. Anytime I wake up in the morning, I am
happy.
I go to rest at night, and I ask the Lord to bless us through the night that we might have a restful night. I go to sleep, and I am in the hands of my Lord at that time. But when I wake up on my own, or my wife says, it's 9:30, time for you to get up, it is a blessing. And as we should read the words of God, it should be a blessing to us every day. I'll ask you to please open your Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy 8. And I'm going to give you just a few seconds for you to find it. Deuteronomy 8, 10 through 18. Actually, 10 to 14, and then 16 through 18, 17. Deuteronomy 8, 10 through 14. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he has given thee. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God, and not keeping his commandments, and his judgments, and his statutes, which I command you this day. Lest then thou hast eaten and art full, and hast built goody houses and dwelt therein. And when thy herds and thy flocks multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied, then thy heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Verses 17 and 18. And thou say in thy heart, my power and the might of my hand has gotten me this wealth. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swear unto thy fathers, as it is to this day. May we remember that all that we have, all that we are, It's because of the blessing of our Lord Jesus Christ on his children. Amen.
Thank you for that, Elder Lou, and thank you to all the participants who have blessed us today, those who have blessed us from up front here, also from those who have been a blessing throughout the Sabbath school times and up in the audiovisual booth. Really appreciate all of you. It was a blessing to be here the first Sabbath of the month, 2 weeks ago, not part of my regular schedule, but in this period where Pastor Nathaniel is taking some family leave time, I'm doing my best to be here every other week. And it was a blessing to hear Brett's music. I loved how he combined two songs into one. Thursday and Friday, I was wondering, I wonder if I can do that. Can I blend two songs into one like that? And I figured I'd better just do what I know that I'm able to do. But then I'm also thankful to him for preaching last week. Much appreciative of those who are stepping up to fill the pulpit in the weeks that were away. Good. Well, we are now 20 years and 1 week removed from the horrific day that certainly the majority of us in this sanctuary remember, September 11th, 2001. We probably spent a lot of time thinking recently about how we felt on 9/11 and about the sights and sounds of that day. In a sense, it happened very far away from us, but in a sense, it happened very near to our hearts, yes? Can you remember? 9/11 was more than a one-day event, wasn't it? I'm going to ask you to go back in your minds to how you were feeling 20 years ago today, 1 week after 9/11. By that time, the smoke had cleared. They had pretty good accounting of who was accounted for, who was unaccounted for. Of course, there would still be months of work at Ground Zero getting that cleaned up and put away and rebuilt. But for days afterwards, we felt shock and dismay, perhaps fear for a time. That's actually what the terrorists wanted, right? That's the definition of terrorism, that wicked-minded people get their way by causing fear in others. Perhaps we walked around for several days or even weeks feeling like zombies or something in a haze. But I remember that pretty quickly, probably within those first few days, and definitely by a week later, those initial feelings had given way to resolve. Resolve to bounce back, resolve to build again, resolve to defy and to defeat terrorism, and resolve to unify in our American identity and patriotism. I didn't synchronize with my mom about those flags on the walk today, but there was a sense of pride, especially in the immediate wake of 9/11, wasn't there? About being Americans and principles of liberty and democracy, and we weren't going to shrink back, were we, in the face of terrorism. And there was a phrase that summarized those feelings that arose, I think, gradually. I don't know if it arose within that first week, but definitely within the first couple of months. A phrase that spoke of determination and perseverance and valor and honor. The phrase, we will never forget. We will never forget the lessons of September 11th. We will never get complacent. We will never let our guard down. We will never bow the knee to intimidation from foes. We will never forget. Well, now that we're 20 years in, it's a big number anniversary that just went by last week. You probably saw commemorations that were shown on the news and things. 20 years on, how are we in terms of never forgetting? Have we stuck to that resolve? Have we stuck to that determination? How are we doing as a society 20 years later? Honestly, other than periods when an anniversary is coming up, how often do you think of 9/11 and those principles of it? I'd say I could probably easily go a week, if not 2 weeks, if not 3 weeks, not thinking about it 20 years later. In fact, a big help for me has been on the 57 freeway. I don't know if you drive the 57 often over near Angel Stadium. There is a tower there that is a fire, it's owned by the fire department, and sometimes you see it billowing with smoke because it's a practice building for the firefighters. Sometimes you'll see them shooting water on it from the outside. I imagine sometimes firefighters are running up on the inside, but this is the mural that they painted on the side. It was apparently refreshed just about 5 years ago. Never forget 9/11 of 2001. When I drive by that building, I remember. But if it wasn't for the building, how often would I remember? Probably not too often. It's dim from our minds, hasn't it? We said we would never forget. As a society, are we forgetting or not? You can go back onto the sermon title slide now. I suppose that that phrase, "we will never forget," begs the question, just what is it we are to never forget? What is it about 9/11 that's worth remembering and preserving in our society? Just what are we supposed to remember about that day and its immediate aftermath? Would it be the innocent lives that were lost? Just under 3,000, I think it was something like 2,977. Are those worth remembering? Those are definitely worth remembering, are they not, friends? I find myself moved every time their names are solemnly read. And I saw a news clip that was done at Ground Zero last weekend. I'm glad that they were commemorated. People who started their day just thinking they were going to work, thinking it was another day. How many days do we just, it's what we do every day. And these folks had their life blotted out. Friends, we need to live every day with, yes, hope and expectations for a future, but also the realization today is the only day that's guaranteed. Amen? Amen? What else shall we never forget? What about the bravery and the heroism of that day? Is that worth remembering? I do marvel and respect those people who ran toward the smoking towers and up the stairwells, thinking of others first in disregard to their own safety. That absolutely needs to be remembered and commemorated and lifted up as an example of valor. Yes? It is worth aspiring to the rest of us. I hope that if I saw an emergency, I would run toward it rather than away from it. None of us knows how we would react to an emergency. These folks signed up for it, most of them, right? Police officers, fire personnel, ambulances. Boy, they had a hard choice, but their duty called them toward the towers and toward the Pentagon and toward that field in Pennsylvania. Definitely needs to be held up. And those heroes that are still living, we need to live thankfully to them. What else about 9/11 should we never forget? You may remember that in the weeks and the months following, there was great patriotism, great national unity that arose in the wake of 9/11. Is that worth remembering? Is that worth aspiring to? How have we been doing on that in recent years? I find myself fondly remembering the time when people were largely united in their pride to be Americans and in having a pretty non-controversially popular president. I remember hearing of approval ratings in the 80% and low 90%, something unheard of in recent years, yes? Perhaps we've forgotten that lesson. Should it take a tragedy to bring us together? You may remember that that unity and patriotism, though, had a dark and unfortunate backside to it. Do you remember? In the form of religious and racial prejudice and bigotry and crimes that took place against Muslims that was also a part of the wake after 9/11? Is that an indelible part of 9/11 that should never be forgotten too? I remember hearing that hate speech and vandalism and looting and attacks also spread among members of the Hindu and Sikh communities. Now, if you know anything about the religions of Hinduism and Sikhism, they have nothing to do with Islam. But hateful people showed their ignorance as well as their hatred in not even being discerning. And even within the Muslim community, did Muslims in California, our immediate neighborhood, have anything to do with that? How would we like to be stereotyped by the worst members and the worst actors of Christianity? And someone was pointing the finger at us, "Oh, you Christians are the same, you're terrible." I'm not terrible. I'm aspiring to be like my Lord, who's wonderful. Jesus said the golden rule, right? Treat others as you would like to be treated. Shouldn't it be an extension of the golden rule that if we wouldn't want to be stereotyped for the worst actors in Christianity, that we shouldn't stereotype an entire religion based on their worst actors? So when we say, 20 years later, we will never forget, can we keep the good while leaving the bad? Is that possible in our human nature? I, for one, do hope that we can separate out the positive aspects of what happened after 9/11, separate it out from the negative ones, and live our best collective life as a society in light of those lessons. They say that those who forget the past, you remember, are condemned to repeat it. And so unless we don't want to replace scenes like that, let's keep that present in our minds, the parts that are worth keeping. It's tough though. We as Westerners are notoriously a short-minded society. History tends to fade off really quickly for us, more than other cultures and other societies in the world. Think of it. Before 9/11, what was the last great tragedy that was even on par with 9/11? Probably the attack on Pearl Harbor back in December of 1941. In fact, I looked it up. Almost an identical number of people died with Pearl Harbor as died with 9/11. Very different in a sense, but it was one of those things that entire American culture was shocked. And it got us into World War II, of course. But friends, how often do we think of Pearl Harbor in our day-to-day lives? I had said maybe 2 or 3 weeks with 9/11, unless I had that building reminding me. I could probably go a year not thinking of Pearl Harbor. And that isn't that far off of the horizon in the past, right? Let's see, 80 years this December. I'm sure there'll be a big commemoration in Pearl Harbor. I'm glad we have these big numbers and commemorations, but boy, outside of that. Probably barely any people alive who remember Pearl Harbor themselves. And soon those folks will be gone too. Will Pearl Harbor, will 9/11 simply be relegated to the history books like Pearl Harbor was, or will we learn lasting lessons? So I don't know, I want to keep the good. I want to discard the bad, keep the good, but our record as a society isn't great for remembering things that are more than just a couple decades away. It'll be interesting to know. I'm sure there'll be another big one at 25 years, but after that, maybe only every 5 or 10 years will we even kind of remember 9/11. I'll tell you something, friends. Our scripture reading today talked about something even more dangerous than learning, than forgetting the lessons of Pearl Harbor or 9/11. More dangerous than forgetting those. It is forgetting the lessons, the overall testimony of previous generations in terms of what happens to a person's life and to a society when they stay with God versus when they forget God. Those of us who are reading through the Bible, we are reading right now about Israel's demise. And it's ironic because two books of the Bible we're in right now, 2 Samuel and Ezekiel, they're kind of like bookends of Israel's history. You've got David and Israel's rising to the glory days. But even when I read about the glory days of Israel, it's with a bitter feeling in my stomach because I know what the end of Israel is. We're also in the book of Ezekiel where the waves of invasions are beginning to come in and Israel is losing its land. How far apart did that happen? How far apart from when Israel got the land with Joshua to when they lost the land? Anybody have a ballpark? 500 to guess? It's more than 500? Closer to 800 years, 750 or 800 years. Comparatively, how old are we as a country, United States of America? 200, I did the math, I believe it's 271. Is that right? Did I get it right? 76, we're coming up to 26. We're 5 years short of 250, I'm sorry, it's 246. Okay, something like that. Anyway, it's a lot shorter, right? Compared to 750 or 800 years. And we read the Bible and we say, oh man, Israel, why couldn't you keep it together? They did keep it together 600, 700 years. What's our likelihood as United States society, remembering our God 700, 800 years, if where we are now is just under 241, I think, if I got the math right? Are we going to make it? Are we going to make it another 250 to get halfway to 500, you know? I tell you, I worry about the trends. I worry about the trends. And God had warned about the exact thing. Let's read this passage once more. Deuteronomy chapter 8. I believe it is key, friends, that we keep this in mind. God knew it was tough. That's why he reminds us so often. But this one is such a clear one. Deuteronomy 8. I feel like the few decades I've been alive, I have perceived a real shift. Deuteronomy 8, starting with verse 10. Please open your Bibles. There should be a Bible in the pew in front of you, or otherwise a device is fine as well. I happen to be reading out of New King James today. Deuteronomy 8, starting with verse 10. When you have eaten and are full, right, when things are going well, bless Yahweh your God for the good land he has given you. We should always express appreciation. Where? To God. Because similarly, he has given us a good land, has he not? Verse 11, beware that you do not forget Yahweh your God by not keeping his commandments, his judgments, and his statutes, which I command you today. You know, sometimes we as Adventists get the finger pointed at us for being commandment keepers, and people say, legalists! And I don't, we are not legalists. We believe the blood of Jesus Christ and his grace and favor, unmerited, is the only way to salvation. But I will not deny that commandment keeping is a big part of keeping in God's will. That's New Testament too. If you love me, keep my commandments. 1 John, this is love, that we keep God's commandments. Do not forget, but keep them habitually. Verse 12, lest when you have eaten and are full and have built beautiful houses and dwell in them. Mom showed several of them today in the children's story. And when your herds and your flocks multiply and your silver or gold are multiplied and all that you have is multiplied. When your heart is lifted up and you forget Yahweh your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. Don't forget, you haven't deserved any of this. It is only God's favor. Friends, most of us were born into a society that I would say would be the envy of the world, historically and geographically. We live in one of the nicest places possible, historically and geographically, right? Anybody would love to be here. But did we make it? Did we make the nice weather? Did we make the fertile soil? We are in a land of peace and prosperity, dear brothers and sisters, and this warning is as much for us as it was for the Israelites. Do not forget, is God's testimony. And previous generations have stood firm and have said, we will not forget, we will live it, we will pass it to the next generation. Well now, friends, we are the next generation, we are the current generation. But if we gradually forget, will America follow the path of Israel? They say the definition of intelligence is to learn from others' mistakes. Right? It's one to learn from one's own mistakes and do better, that's great. But to learn from others' mistakes, previous generations' mistakes, warnings in Scripture, that is the definition of spiritual intelligence. Yes? Jumping down to verses 17 and 18. Then you may say in your heart, my power and the might of my hand have gained me this wealth. Yet you shall remember Yahweh your God, for it is he who gives you the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore to your forefathers, as it is this day. So friends, very simple question as we begin to wrap up. As we look at our society, do we see a society that says we are thankful to God for the blessings we have? Or is it more like, my wealth, my power, the strength of my hands has gotten me this wealth? Which is it? Coming up next month, we've got Thanksgiving. My favorite holiday, actually. My favorite holiday. What are the chances it doesn't get covered up by more profitable holidays, by the retailers and by the theme parks and all these different things? Thanksgiving is being forgotten, dear friends. I worry about our society, friends. There's not a chance if in the church we forget, correct? We need to make a stand and say we will never forget. That way we may be reminding our society that it will never forget. And I pray, I know at a certain point you made that resolution in your heart. You chose to get up and come to church today in obedience to the commandment. Yes, at some point you did it. And so congratulations. In a sense, I know I'm preaching to the choir. But friends, it's more than resolving on a single day, isn't it? Imagine Jesus comes in 2035, 14 years from now, okay? Maybe we've been going to church, maybe we haven't been going to church, but on Judgment Day, you're before the Lord and you say, but I remember, back in 2021, I resolved to never forget. Is that going to make us stand on the day? Is it a single day's resolution, or is it a continual resolution to never forget? What do you think, friends? I think it needs to be continual. So today, I want to lead you in affirming that we will never forget the numerous benefits and blessings that God has given us to be in this society. But I also want to urge you, it is not the work of a day, no matter how strongly. If we were to stay here till 4 o'clock in the afternoon, cementing it in, it wouldn't help us for next week, next month, next year, because it needs to be a continual resolution in our hearts to never forget. Amen? Amen? I want you to repeat the line after me. Can you repeat, we will never forget? We will never forget. And I've got a laundry list of all the things that Lord has done, and I pray it'll seep deep down in our hearts the resolution to not forget. So it starts like this. We will never forget God's bountiful goodness to us. We will never forget. We will never forget that He is the creator of all and sustainer of all. We will never forget. We will never forget that Jesus came to live among us, to minister to us, and to die for us. We will never forget. We will never forget that He rose again and promises to share His victory of resurrection with all who come to Him in faith and love. We will never forget. We will never forget that a key component of loving God who we haven't seen is loving our neighbors who we have seen. We will never forget. We will never forget to pray, to study, to speak well of God at every opportunity. We will never forget. We will never forget to teach our children about Him. We will never forget. We will never forget to order our daily lives around His principles. We will never forget. We will never forget to rejoice in the Lord always. We will never forget. We will never forget to affirm that Jesus Christ gives abundant life and no one else. We will never forget. We will never forget that we owe our very lives to Him. We will never forget. After all, it says in 1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20, you are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Nothing less, friends, than the blood of Jesus has been shed for our redemption, for our freedom, for our eternity. Say it one last time with me. It's on the screens. We will never forget. Amen, friends. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for the firm resolve in our hearts that we will never forget the Lord and His many, many mercies. It's a great thing we've done today, and I pray that it is pleasing in God's sight. But the Christian walk is a daily walk. We are not merely Seventh-day Adventists to the exclusion of the other 6 days, are we? We only remember this once a week. Once a week is a good reminder. It's good. If we were to do the minimum of that, as the commandment says, we would not be able to deviate too far. But we're more than one day a week Christians, aren't we, dear friends? Maybe we should drop off the TH occasionally and remind ourselves we are Seventh-day Adventists. Adventist means we're anticipating the coming of our Lord Jesus. I pray that we say in our hearts every day, come quickly, Lord Jesus. And in the meantime, help me to be a good witness and a good example and a good encouragement to folks who have not yet heard the fullness of the good news or put their hope in you the way that we have. Friends, it's important that we remember national events that shape our society. But there is a cause far beyond that, far behind that is infinitely deeper and more important. Can I hear an amen on that? Amen. If we forget God, the giver of every good gift, woe to us, because there will be no bright horizon at all for our country or for us if we forget the Lord. Amen? So, even more foundational than remembering 9/11 and its principles, remember the Lord and His principles. Amen, dear friends? As for me and my household, we will never forget. I pray that you make the same resolution day in, day out for you and your households. Amen? Amen. I don't know about you, I think this merits a song, huh? Why don't we sing, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus, No Turning Back. Yes? Let's sing. Go to our song slide here.
Yeah.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Closeness, increased intimacy, increased glory with you, dear Heavenly Father. Thank you for each brother and sister who has come today. We pray for the broader family of dear brothers and sisters who may not be here today for one way or another. We pray for every sincere Christian worshiping you on this, the glorious day that you have made. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that we will be kept safe and healthy in your hand. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, that Brother Daryl, thank you that he is back home and recovering. We pray that he'll be back with us before too long, dear Heavenly Father. Please bless the rest of our day and our families. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you so much for worshiping with us, dear friends. Forgive my mental hiccup there during the prayer that happens occasionally. We want to remind you that it is through your generous offerings for the local church and, of course, our tithes that we return to God that the ministry is sustained both here at the local church through the offerings and through broader Southeastern California Conference through your tithes. So if you are able, please do make a donation on the way out. Some of our leaders may have seen the email that we are moving up board meeting a week. So Monday night we will be discussing matters of the church. So everybody please pray for our leaders that we may guide this church forward while it is still a difficult time. But we're wanting to add more, you know, activities and add more of a complete experience on Sabbath mornings. So please, of course, if you have any agenda items, email them to me before Monday evening. We'll be happy to discuss them. I was communicating with Tiffany Bo this week. You may remember that she was here a couple of weeks ago talking about a health and wellness seminar. So far, we haven't had a lot of interest expressed, but she said that she is willing to do it personally, even if there are just 5 or 10 interests. So if you are feeling stressed or down, this is, of course, on a moderate level. It's not like a psychiatry or, you know, intense therapy, but if you would like to spend some Sabbath afternoons learning processes about general healthfulness, and restfulness, mindfulness, optimism. We are hoping to start those still about halfway through October. So don't hesitate to mention it to us here. We pray a blessing on your week. It's a big week for the Calder family. Their son is getting married. Is it next Sunday? Out in Texas. And so big day for Doug. Many of us probably know Doug. Getting married. And we wish, of course, a blessing on them for their travels and for Doug for a wonderful future happiness with his wife. Anything else major that I forget? All right, I'll be outside to greet you on the way out. Feel free to mingle as long as you like. God bless you.